Welcome everyone to the feminist panel. So this is going to be more of a kind of discussion thing. The speakers are going to speak very briefly, apart from Elife, who's going to speak a wee bit longer. First of all, we have Elife here, who's a member of the KGR, the Free Women's Congress, and is working in the collective of Jineology Journal, which is what she's mainly going to be speaking about. And then we have Suzanne, who has left every group she's ever joined because of respectability politics. And then we have Claire from ARC and Teresa, who describes herself as a feminist killjoy. So we're just going to start with Elife here.
You're against that with me?
Yeah.
Thank you. You are all welcome. I'm a member and activist of Free Women Congress, in English known as Kongreye Jinen Azat, in Kurdish Keja, and we came from Kurdistan, North Kurdistan, Bakur, southeast of Turkey. So many of our friends were in yesterday evening speech, so I won't talk much about the struggle of Keja and the structure of Keja, how Free Women Congress works, what they do, because Hebal Ayşe, is she here? Ayşe is not here yet, I suppose. They already talk about it. But I want to make my speech on a new concept that we are newly working on. We call it genealogy. Genealogy is it is meaning signs of women, and can be also signs of life, because Jin is in Kurdish also means women and life. So genealogy comes from the Kurdish origin, and logi is, as you know, logi, science, the science reflections. And up to now, in our 40 years struggle, the point that we come today is the arguments and the works on genealogy. So and. We try to just bring a new approach to women's struggle and women epistemology by this concept, and not only in Kurdistan, worldwide, in other parts of the world, with other women's struggles. We want to share ideas, we want to share our experiences and our knowledges. So we would like to present you what do we mean by genealogy, what's our aim, and where does it streams from. If you don't mind, I'd like to just do my presentation by reading. I have some preparations. I'd like to make it by speech, but anyway, I want it to be understood better. So my English is not that much better. So even though genealogy as a concept emerged recently, it has come into being as a consequence of our long-term struggle. The debates on genealogy come into our agenda after the publishing of the book titled Sociology of Freedom, written by the Kurdish people's leader, Abdullah Öcalan. This concept of genealogy means the rebuilding of a society from a women-centered scientific approach that, through which long-struggling democratic forces, which are not yet able to establish a system, will actively take place. Of course, this topic is a comprehensive one, yet we would all together look for the answers to following questions: where to begin, what to do, how to do. In order to answer these questions, there's a necessity to overcome the boundaries drawn and the knots knotted around women. Again, we believe that together with the collapse of the definition of womanhood made by sovereigns, we will be able to take a new road towards democracy. Therefore, we consider that the main cause of the non-success of the social women's and of struggles up to now lies in the issue that social movements, social networks around women are not analyzed in a correct manner. Indeed, in the non-inclusion of women into scientific studies, who constitute a significant part of social nature, has to be raised as a question. Yet there is no doubt that there are multiple reasons behind that. The identity of women, women's nature, beyond being a gender and sexual identity, involves a comprehensive meanings with economic, social, political dimensions. In this sense, the enlightenment of the nature of the woman will bring at the same time the enlightenment of the nature of society. There is then a need to clarify the position of women who are considered as the first colonies from the time of the history of women's colonization to their economic, political and mental intellectual colonization. Therefore, we think that genealogy will have a great contribution for the revelation and clarification of every aspect of the societal problems and for their solutions. Along with defining the existing status of women, the questions of women liberation is also a primary topic for consideration. The solution to this problem and the way of solving it is of vital importance. We think that in practical terms, determining the connections between the freedom of society and the freedom of women will be realized through carrying out a struggle in every sense. In order to make the determination of those connections, we are in a continuous systematic search for theory, program, organizations, and action systems. With the belief that society would not be liberated without women, we likewise believe that without women, democratic politics wouldn't exist. The environment cannot be protected, and also the ethic and aesthetic values of the environment cannot acquire their actual meanings. We, as women participating in the freedom movement, have begun to struggle first by trying to break our ties with capitalist civilization, before everything else. In doing so, we have set our critical measures for the acknowledgement and rejection of all ties connecting us with the capitalist system, such as family, career, marriage, and similar bonds. This meant to have a fierce fight against all our imposed and enforced statues. We didn't stop only at participating in the arenas of struggle. Of course, in these fields of struggle, we continue to quest for discovering ourselves and developing a form of self-awareness and self-realization. In this painful process, we have learned how to become ourselves first at the institutions we established by trusting on our self-power. We have faced with our reality of self-alienation and of alienation from our fellow women. We have intensified our trainings about the importance of gender awareness on these issues. Our alienation about many issues, such as awareness of gender, gender identity, we can call it womanhood identity, and gender love, women love, we can say, is discussed in independent women-only spaces by relying on our self-power, self-consciousness. Of course, all these processes in which we had an intense fight have passed quite painfully. We learned this painfulness of the process of developing self-awareness and of struggles against capitalist civilization forces, particularly from the resisting women, who resist and throw themselves from the hills, who turn themselves into fireballs and explode themselves by turning themselves into bombs. Therefore, in order to represent a larger resistance against all the internal and external reactions, we have to organize and institutionalize in all spheres of life. The main point that we want to emphasize is we have all done this, yet we have failed to bring those debates in the platforms outside our own one. One of the main reasons behind this is the blackening and isolation targeting our movement in the international arena. And the other reason is Orientalist and positivist perspectives in general towards the women's struggle for freedom. These two conditions have limited the possibilities for sharing our ongoing discussions within other platforms. In this respect, we believe that our experience of life and struggle is not adequately examined. We have analyzed the experiences of World Women's Movement in many ways, and we have made many assessments and critiques on these movements. However, what we notice is that Eurocentric women's movements constitute the main axis of the narratives of women history. In the analysis of women's movements in the Middle East, a dominant modernist approach has emerged. There is this assumption that there is no resistance other than the one created by the defenders of modernity. In a geography like the Middle East, women live under very intense form of colonization. However, despite our multifaceted developments in the arenas ranging from the fields of politics and military and to our organized social force to institutionalization, our experience on women's freedom is still not sufficiently explained. Yet, behind the most current developments in Shangal and Kobane, there is an intense accumulation of mental, intellectual, theoretical and practical knowledge. For many years, the topics like sexism, feminist history, or history of women's freedom from the Neolithic society to today, and the historical analysis of women's culture as well as the critique of sexist history are discussed as the core courses in our training. Thousands of young people are trained on the axis of these issues. The approach to women's liberation as significant criteria is discussed on the basis of old status, achievements and works that we have had. On this ground, while theories are not taken as functioning independent of the practice, each consequence of our practices is subjected to a constant re-evaluation. The life stories of hundreds of women demonstrating their commitment to women's struggle for freedom at the expense of their lives have been reflected in the results of our consciousness. These are the stories of our acquired consciousness and achieved will, as well as our brave participation in life. We have been living through the processes of the development of meeting between communal life and ecology rather than the one between individualism and consumerism. In this respect, genealogy is the claim to play the role of a pool that brings together these results of all the accumulated knowledge on our thought, practice and development. And it's also the claim to evaluate the consequences of this revealed practice as these results are intended to be devoted to all the women. We do not consider genealogy as the one rejecting or denying feminism and women's studies together with their organization and institutions, while it doesn't aim to unite them under one larger umbrella organization. We believe that developing a women-centered science is a necessity to reach a true sociological approach. While we examine all the issues we have addressed through their organizations and structures from the depths of history to today, we view genealogy as including the transformation of women based on the freedom of women, society, as a social science study. It's acknowledged by everyone that social science approaches taking the state as the basic unit of society as well as economy and religion as its core issues. They do not eliminate social facts and problems and do not make us reach to right results. In this respect, genealogy takes the examination of the definition of women and of their roles in life as the core issues in order to solve the origins of social problems. This means that it's not just the science that prioritizes studying and producing knowledge in favor of women. We believe that all social sciences should have a social perspective, as this society historically and currently is required to be shaped around women. Social problems will be solved through free women's perspective. From now on, deciphering masculine character in the understanding of science in every aspect and also in analyzing the definitions of women in the fields of religion, art and philosophy has to be emphasized. These definitions of women and understandings of life developed in the mainstream scientific, philosophical, religious and artistic approaches are the main sources of today's serious social problems. We are aware that we are not the first ones expressing these issues. In years, there have been many works written and produced on this subject. We have continuously strived for examining and understanding these works. A feminist epistemology, deciphering of male-dominated knowledge structure, the need for writing a new history of women, women's embracement of their own bodies and produced, and their labor and willpower are the concrete proofs of valuable works that have been produced. However, the knowledge critiques and researches do not turn into a complete system and perspective because they take the individual as the center of analysis instead of society, not touching women's lives. This knowledge doesn't create any change in the lives of women who are forced to live through everyday exploitation and different forms of massacre in their lives. The reasons behind these issues have to be questioned. These existing studies have a limited access to particular segment of women and have produced limited knowledge only at the gender and women's studies departments at the dominant universities teaching under the rule of hegemonic system. Feminist scholars' efforts have been made in narrow arenas, while knowledge production is kept under the possession of hegemonic system and is sold for a paid labor, the return of the works of scholars has been limited. However, genealogy will be a form of knowledge produced at the alternative academies, where produced knowledge will be devoted to the whole society, and it also aims to infuse this knowledge into lives of people. We therefore talk about the new forms of academies, which will employ plain language and communication tools that every woman might have access to. Genealogy must involve all the information and fields of science through which we as women will be able to overcome the existing male domination. At this point, we imagine genealogy as the framework that would organize the knowledge produced as well as that would push for resistance and struggle. These are imagined not as utopias or desires, yet we consider them as the works that we are going to realize, yet they are in the need of more exploration and of circulation. These are also the works that we already have the required practical tools to develop starting from today. It's obvious that our efforts alone will be quite limited and also our gains alone will not be permanent. In this sense, we define the feminist and women's movements as our significant heritage that we rely on. Since these feminist and women's movements are the rebellions of the last colonies in the history of resistance, have developed against the colonization of women in the history. We believe that our commonalities and similarities have to be multiplied and reach out all the society. While we attribute a great value to the efforts and experiences of feminist movements, there are some issues that we criticize and look for solutions with genealogy. We think that these critics and our search for solutions will contribute to overcoming the problems which feminist movements have experienced. The frustration felt with the experience of real socialism and liberal social liberation projects together with the silencing of different religions, cultures and others has resulted in the attitudes that are either too cautious or completely denialist. The judgment everyone has his or her own truth, generating a fragmentation of theory and practice, renders the anti-hegemonic forces vulnerable and leads to their marginalization and to the non-solution of social problems. These anti-hegemonic forces are pushed to a position that looks for solutions within the system itself instead of intending to create a radical transformation of the system that pursues revolutionary goals. What we critique is not just to have a struggle within the system, because we do not completely project a fight only outside the system. Actually, the issue, the critique is the ways that these struggles have followed within the system, which do not overcome systems' knowledge structures, while taking the hegemonic institutions as the basis of their struggle. Liberalism, as melting all the ideologies and lifestyles within itself, its theory and practice has generated serious problems with respect to holding the consistent positions of having struggle. This is also reflected in the women's movements, which make demands from the state as that they rely too much on the state law and legal arrangements. In other words, we critique the non-rejections of modernist life. We think that feminism deeply experiences this issue and should make critique of this. I'm coming to end. So, our tradition of resistance is predicated on a women's struggle of about half century old, 40 years, we can say exactly, deriving its determination from the resistance of the oppressed, including the women and the peoples. It's true that our struggle was and will be long-running, as we are aiming for building the system of democratic modernity, founded on a democratic, ecological, and women emancipatory paradigm. We retrace the mentality of a system which roots the nature, exterminates life, decimates the society, and massacres the women on a daily basis. It's obvious that the codes and practices of the civilization on which the system of capitalist modernity relies is enemy to the women, life, and society. With the science of women, society, and life, that's genealogy, we are aspiring to find answers appropriate for the fabric on an ethical, political society, which, despite its long history of resistance, has failed to construct a system in and a system for itself. So, on these arguments, we just start to publish a new journal, Jineology Journal. We have its first issue on 8th of March, and we are working on the second issue nowadays. This Jineology Journal wishes to broaden the pool into which the creativity and experiences of women who have set out with similar aims, goodwill, and enormous amount of labor in the past have poured in order to water the soil of freedom nurturing the social life. Our objective is to open ways to new forms, instruments, and goals of knowing as against those distorted by the perpetual interventions of the capitalist modernity of today's world, and to create women emancipation along with society's people's emancipation. That's all. Thank you for listening. It was a little bit long, but we can just open it with questions. Thank you.
So we're just going to move on before we take any questions. So Suzanne, do you want to go?
I feel like what I have to say now is going to sound very petty in kind of comparison to what's...
Don't compare, just...
to what's went on. And I was like, because this is about kind of our experiences of feminist struggle, I was trying to think back about what was the first protest I was ever at. And this is really sad, and for people outside of Ireland, that won't make much sense. But the first protest I was ever at was Drumcree in 1997 on the side of the Orange Men forcing themselves down the Gravaki Road. But I was 7, so I feel like I can be excused for that. I'm really impressed with this meeting in that there's so many people here that I don't know. When I first moved to Dublin, 2009, I knew everybody, but maybe not to talk to, but I knew them to see. And I think what I want to talk about today kind of revolves around that. That while I look around this room too, there's an awful lot of people that I was engaged in struggles with who aren't here. they've decided that they can't come to this because of the kind of lack of community that exists in feminism in Ireland, where an awful lot of the time the feminist community, whether it means to or not, will defend abusers, they'll defend rapists, they'll let them into their community and they won't question it. There's women who because I'm seen as a bit of a dick, I see things very black and white and have no problem cutting people off. So a lot of women tend to come to me with their stories of assault and abuse and who's done what to who. And I think, and these people are still active in our communities, and these women are terrified of being named, of being outed, of confronting anybody in any way. Instead, what they've chose to do is just leave. They're not involved. They won't get involved. They won't even come into the area of Smithfield today because of who they're afraid to see. And I get that me sitting here, I have this platform to kind of say that. And it was this internal debate of, oh, Suzanne, you're going to be a dick again. You're going to say the most offensive thing you possibly can. Maybe you should do your nice talk on women in STEM. But it's kind of, it does make me really sad, this lack of community. Like, my community, the Protestant working class community in Belfast, has shit tons of problems. It's racist, it's sexist, it's sectarian. But there is a community. If I was in trouble, people would defend me. If I got arrested, they'd pay my bail. Maybe not now, but like previously. And it is moving down here. It felt really isolating. I still feel quite isolated. And I think as women, we have to struggle really hard to be part of protest movements. Like, as Fionnuala introduced me, I've left everything pretty much I've ever been a part of, apart from groups I founded. But like, when I go to water charges protests, the amount of misogyny, the amount of people we tolerate that are pro-life, that are anti-sex work, that are anti-trans people, like, I don't get why these movements are touted as these great kind of successes on the left when they're not. There's members of youth defence that I have to encounter every time I go on a protest. I've had an illegal abortion. I face prison. But like, why are these men tolerated? Why are they let into our movements? It wasn't until, I'd say, 2 years ago when I went to Berlin. And in Berlin was their March for Life, their giant pro-life march. And it was just so nice to not have to take out all my piercings, to have to look a certain way in order to be taken seriously. That the fact that I was a woman and I'd had an abortion meant that this was a serious issue for me. The fact that you could call these people fascist because they wanted to control your body. If I started calling pro-life members of the Water Charges Movement fascist, I'd be smacked. Like, I just don't get why we're tolerating these people, why we're pushing young women out constantly out of this movement because they're afraid of the men in it. Like, that is not a space I want to be part of. It's not a space anybody should want to be part of. And I feel bad because I have no solutions for this. My solution to this has been to isolate myself, to cut people off, to just not get involved. And I think it's a conversation we really need to have. Where are these young women that we started out in struggles with, that fought to be in struggles? Where are they? Why are they not here? And what are we going to do about it?
So we're just going to have Claire from Ireland.
Hi. I doubt mine will be as personal or as powerful as Suzanne or Elif's, but I'm just here to try and give you guys a bit of an idea of what the abortion rights campaign is about and what we do. So we were established a couple of years ago, in between 2011 and 2012, it's a bit blurry, as the Irish Choice Network, and then we took on the name Abortion Rights Campaign. And it was always really important to us to have the word abortion in the name, to make people say the word, because as we've learned from the other side and from the unfortunate 40-year legacy of activism in this country, the control of language is sort of everything. And when they say that they are pro-life, we can look at them and say, absolutely, that's not the case. But we are pro-choice and we're pro-abortion and we're pro-life. And we are pro all of the good parts of it, I guess. So abortion rights campaign structure is completely horizontal. And I think for me, it's what I consider to be one of the biggest successes of ARC, and the reason that we are sustainable as a campaign. There are five working groups. They're actions, admin, policy and advocacy, partnerships and outreach, and media. And you can just join up based on a campaign, or you can join a particular group depending on what you're interested in. And the structure means that you're not really answerable to anybody above or below. Those axes of power don't really exist in ARC. You come along and you might have an idea and you want to implement it, and you reach out and other people will be there, like-minded, and it starts to get put into action. And I've floated around a few of the different groups now for several years, it's always brilliant to see how effective that non-hierarchical structure is, because it means that people are completely responsible for what they're doing, and that if then they need to take a break, and it's really natural in activism that there's always a bit of burnout. Once you're finished, you can do that, and there's never responsibility resting on you from other people to force yourself to keep pushing past the point of no return in activism. But there is, I think, quite a good spirit of support and understanding. And that brings me to another one of the main things that I think makes ARC so brilliant, is that it's women-led. There are a couple of men dotted around the campaign, but it's almost entirely run by women. And we've had people comment on our meetings that we can get more done in an hour than any other groups they've ever seen. And I completely think that it's because we use our time wisely, and because we can communicate. I think there's a lot less ego in the room when the thing is woman-led, and that saves a lot of time. And a lot of arguments can just happen, and we move on, and it's productive, and that's just how it goes. So what we've been doing is, in the last while, we had some political advocacy training that some of you might have seen. We were trying to get people empowered to talk to their TDs in the run-up to the general elections, which I think was a great success based on the feedback that we got from the trainings. And then it was part of the programme of the training that we would get feedback after they had spoken to their local representatives as well, that it started to make people in positions of power, or people trying to get to positions of power, realise that the vast majority of people are pro-choice and that they want politicians to represent that for them. We also have been able to map then the support politically around the country and steer all our energy where it's needed. There are certain minds that are never going to be changed, and we know this, everybody knows it. So it's best to just spend the energy on people who actually all they need is some education about the issues. And almost all of the time, once somebody knows the full story about abortion, they're inevitably pro-choice and pro-women. We also have a women's community education course that was rolled out last year, and that was really, really well received. It was written alongside and with consultation from all these different groups. So we worked with Pavi Point, I think we were with Teddy. I wrote down the list because it's really long and I never remember. And the IFPA, the IFPA, Reproductive Health, AIMS, the Association of Improvement for Maternity Services, and AKIDWA. And that has been a huge education for people in ARC as well, I think, just to see where abortion is really needed, information about abortion is really needed, because it's quite clear from the names that you see in the news and the women who are dying that it is a very particular subset of the community that these laws are affecting disproportionately. It's poor women and it's women of colour who are mostly suffering with the Eighth Amendment in the law. And so that's where our energy is now being put. So at the moment we're trying to gather up for the summer. We're trying to fundraise with the Workers' Beer Company. It's an initiative with the Battersea Trade Union. And we are looking, anybody who'd like to come and work at festivals this summer, come and say hello to me afterwards, because we need as many people on deck as we can get. And that funding, that the money that we fundraise, is our bread and butter. It's how we pay rent. Unfortunately for us, we don't have any big American funders yet. But if Chuck Feeney's people are here, I'm still holding their hope. The March for Choice is the kind of big thing on the horizon. The summer is always a really busy, kind of big time for us. And the last Saturday in September is when we try to ramp up all this energy and have a really proactive event, rather than always being reactive to the anti-choice movement or reactive to something awful that has happened to a woman in Ireland, as keeps happening. We try to make the March for Choice something positive, where people can get on the streets and demonstrate the desire for change. We also have put a huge amount of our energy into inclusivity. So it means that our language on the website and in all of our materials is inclusive of trans people affected by abortion restrictions. And also we have a policy that all of our documents are written in plain English. There may be questions of literacy that, or just any kinds of other not atypical neural things, you know what I'm talking about, I can't say the words. We also have translated loads of our documents into other languages. So we have Spanish, Portuguese, French and Polish at the moment. I think we're looking for someone to translate into Russian quite actively. And we're looking, someone has volunteered to translate into Chinese or to Mandarin recently. So again, if anybody here speaks some of the more common languages that we don't have, like Bantu or Igbo, it'd be brilliant for us to be able to have those resources. Because as I say, these abortion restrictions are affecting particular subsets of people who we are really trying our best to get to and to communicate with, to let them know that there are ways around and that it is not something that needs to be stigmatized. You can use the word abortion and that there is help. So that's what we're trying to do.
So Crazy's just going to finish it up before we open it up to the floor.
I am not going to be talking about anything as empowering and inspiring, I think, as the previous speakers, because I'm basically talking from history. And I've done some work talking to women who were involved in republicanism during the Troubles, and women who were feminist organizers at the time. And I'm going to pick up on something that Suzanne was getting at there, and that is, I suppose, looking at asking kind of difficult questions about feminism itself, and kind of looking inward a bit. I suppose there, I always, when I start to talk about feminism in the North, I always come back to this quote from this woman called Una Maran, who helped start up the Falls Women's Centre. She was part of Women Against Imperialism. And when I asked her about the women's movement, she said to me, well, you know, I'm not even sure you can actually say there is a feminist movement or a women's movement in the North, because it's so divided and so fractured. And I suppose that set me off on a journey trying to figure out, well, you know, why might that be the case? And I think it comes back to an unwillingness in the 70s on the part of what I call the mainstream women's movement in the North to take a position either way on the British presence in the North. So Northern Ireland Women's Rights Movement, which was formed in 1975, they automatically took a position of no position. So this kind of pretense of neutrality with respect to what was happening on the streets in the North. And this spilled over into how they organized their meetings. So you know, working class women from Republican and Loyalist communities were coming to meetings, and they told they weren't allowed to talk about the issues that were affecting them in their lives on a daily basis. And that carried through into kind of lots of different splinters and factions, and that took place within the movement. So when, as the prison struggles then intensified, we see this division becoming even more fractured. Women Against Imperialism, which formed in 1980, accused the Northern Ireland Women's Rights Movement of being a bourgeoisie group that was there to protect the interests only of middle-class women. And as a result of this kind of lowest common denominator politics, where you weren't allowed to talk about anything in, you know, that wasn't really respectable, and that included any type of queer politics as well. So issues relating to class, issues relating to sexuality, issues relating to state violence were simply not being talked about by women's movements, and that's where these things should have been talked about. And as a result, there we see kind of what developed, I suppose, just to kind of bring us into, in a way, where we are today, a movement that is not really a movement as such, but one that's dominated by funded NGOs, right? So they're not necessarily autonomous community groups as such, but the dominant groups are people who have taken funding consistently from the state, or after the Good Friday Agreement bought into a lot of funding that came through from peace and reconciliation funding. So I suppose for me, I think that this issue of neutrality and this lowest common denominator politics is really problematic. On one hand, it is interesting because it meant that working class women in Republican and Loyalist areas developed their own feminist politics that were very much tied to women's centres, where they were forced to create their own support networks. But at the same time, aside from the solidarity from groups outside the North, when women needed it most, they got very little support from other feminists. In fact, they were actually looked down upon. They were left in essence to the devices of the state. And I think that the position of neutrality, really, that was adopted, only served to prop up state violence against women. And I suppose for today, that has a lesson, and again, just going back to what Suzanne was talking about, is when we think that we're doing something benign, you know, as feminists and within our groups, we're more than likely doing more harm than good. That we have to actually ask the difficult questions. We can't be afraid of conflict. Conflict is good. Conflict means that we're actually talking about the stuff that is the most difficult, and that's where we, I think, have to go, really.
Does anyone have any questions or anything to add? Just stick your hand up.
So, yeah, I hope I can phrase this in an okay way. I'm always wondering, so, feminist movement and isolation, I think there's a very big problem, even on the left, about competition between women, and we have internalized it's so much we keep reproducing it, even though we are aware, we keep doing it. And I was just wondering if you have any ideas or even what we could do to change that in our society, because I think it would benefit the feminist movement a lot, or even is this a very Western phenomenon, or does it exist in North Kurdistan as well?
Ellen, do you want to direct it to anyone particularly?
No, just any ideas of what we can do on it.
We'll maybe take a few questions and then return to it. Does anyone else have any questions? Yeah.
It's more a comment rather than a question. That's okay. I just wanted to add for the last talk, I just wanted to add that actually in Northern Ireland things are slightly changing. There are some, of course, I'm not trying to deny that divisions are still in place, but there are some feminist groups who are actually working together. I'm talking about Alliance for Choice, I'm talking about the Belfast Feminist Network and Reclaim the Agenda. The question of neutrality, of course, is problematic, but so he's taking sides. And so I just wanted to say that there are people who are trying to work and to work together despite all of the divisions, and they're trying really to focus on building a feminist movement despite all of the problems that there are in place. And so we shouldn't try to write them off, but we should probably make sure to engage with these groups because they're really doing great work.
I have something to add, which is more in the nature of a comment, which is something that's not discussed in feminism generally, is the problems of access to feminism and activism to women with children. There is at least six of us that I know of in the room at the moment, but like that's not representative of women in society in general. Like there's far more of us with children out there who want to be involved, and it's important to bear in mind when we're organising that in order to include women who are mothers, anyone who's a parent, that spaces need to be accessible to children, otherwise you're excluding us. And we have things to say.
Yeah, we'll just take one more and then we'll return the question of internalised misogyny.
I mean, I'm wondering, I don't know who framed the panel, but I'm wondering what's the purpose of the panel in a way, because this, I see four very nice and very important talks, but they mostly didn't talk to each other. And I am wondering, you know, if there is a line that maybe the participants can try to draw as some, you know, maybe thinking, strategical thinking, or just thinking of what's the big issue on the feminist agenda in Ireland. Is it one feminist agenda? Is it two, like the NGOs versus us? Is it three, some of us versus some of others? And, you know, like, so where are we going? And is it one movement? Because I'm sometimes a bit confused. I am a feminist. I live in Ireland. I don't feel very engaged in struggles because it seems to be abortion or not, you know, like kind of a bit split and very fragmented, I would agree. So I'm wondering, you know, where next and what's the sense in the audience about that as well.
So anyone want to take that?
The last question or?
Well, we could poll. Either the first them. One or the last one. That.
I mean, okay, I'm obviously really involved with pro-choice activism. So my frame of reference is pro-choice, but I think that because a lot of activists in Ireland who in other countries might have started their activism in the mid-70s are still here fighting for the exact same thing, there's a generational kind of a legacy here that might have a different sort of a tone in other countries, say in France or Italy, because there was a better kind of pace of progress here in other places and not here. So I think that's why a lot of feminist energy has been put into reproductive rights. But I think I don't think any of those feminisms can be separated out. Like they might be discrete in that you're pro-choice, but I don't think somebody who's not pro-choice is a feminist. And likewise in ARC, our policies would be inclusive and we'd be very wary of TERF and SWERF kind of people. And we're trying to make sure that the feminism that we have in ARC is inclusive and it's properly intersectional and it is bringing along all those different strands of proper modern feminism. So I don't know if that helps at all. I know as well that like there are new groups popping up all over the country under the ARC umbrella at the moment. I know well, there were always groups in Dublin, Galway, Cork and in the North. Alliance for Choice is in Belfast and in Derry. But now we have Sligo Pro-Choice, Kildare Pro-Choice, Wicklow, Kerry. I'm trying to work my way around the country mentally. So there are sort of green shoots that I think might actually largely be feminist groups under the guise of pro-choice. But I think they feed into each other and there's a natural kind of a an intersection with those types of feminism.
Again, thank you. So actually, yesterday we talked about it. Patriarchy is patriarchy in everywhere. So it doesn't matter if it's in North Kurdistan or it's in Ireland or Northern Ireland. It doesn't matter, but it does. It just changes a little bit form. Okay. That and elsewhere, it's same thing. The questions are same. Maybe we need to think about the forms of struggle. how are we, what to do, how to do, to just make strength the struggle, just to make the struggle more broader and more bigger. And actually, we are lucky, and then that in North Kurdistan, especially, our we form ourselves as a congress between belong a confederal system. So we have a unique organization. We have a unique organization. So Free Women Congress is like that. But for the Turkey side, the Turkey. The feminism and the women's struggle in Turkey side is, as the friend told, is very, separated, very fragmented, and there are many agendas. But actually, when you look from the outside, you ask questions: why are they so fragmented? They need to be one under one organization with one organization, but they are so fragmented. So. Maybe we need to question the origin of the problem, origin of the question, where the women question arises, what's our problem with the patriarchy and how the patriarchy works. If we can answer the question of how the patriarchy works, then we can come to the question that friend of us asked. But we are in Northern Kurdistan, for example, in our struggle, we always face this question. From we are just doing training sessions with women, and we are just arguing with the mixed groups, men and women together. And the most popular question is this. So you are women. You just give birth, and you brought, you make the children to grow up, and so then you are the reason of the patriarchy. So you are the reason of this male mentality, male system, because you grow, you educate children, you give birth, you do everything. Then what's the problem? With you, like that, and we are arguing on that, and we come to conclusion that yes, we give birth, yes, we educate our children, yes, we do lots of things, but we are also part of this patriarchal system. So our mentality is also a part of this patriarchal system. So when we talk about freedom of women. Or emancipation of women, we don't talk about that women should just free themselves from men. We said that women should free themselves from the patriarchal system itself, a capitalist system itself, and this is responsibility of women and men together. So our scope is. Not just with the women. So we work with the, we argue with the men, men comrades also, and our question is with the men also, with the men also. We say you have to change yourself. We have to change ourselves, and but the subject of this struggle, not object of this struggle. Is in the core of this struggle, there must be women, because we are colonized first. However, men are also colonized by the patriarchy, women are colonized by patriarchy and by men friends, men biologically, by men also. So maybe just keeping this in mind will be some help to somewhere. We are also the part of patriarchal system and patriarchal mentality, so we have to search for getting rid of these things that patriarchy do to our minds, maybe.
Any more questions? thanks to all of you. I think you're all brilliant. I think this is a really important panel. I have three kids. I was here last year, but I didn't bring my kids today because it's easier and because kids are not, you know, we're all here, we're activists, we're all thinking about these things, right? And I'm so glad to see Sinead here with her kids, you know, and it should be like that, like, you know. And I'm talking about colonialism by patriarchy, there you go. But the point I wanted to make to Suzanne, because it's something I thought it was so great that you brought that issue up, and very honest. Because I've been involved in anti-waters, charges, protests, and so on. And like a lot of the people, well, many of the people involved are anti-feminist, anti-choice, racist. Okay? It is a dilemma. It's a huge dilemma. Because, I mean, something like the water charges issue is kind of a lightning rod for the left and for the extreme right as well. You know, and this, you know, you're going to meet people on such an issue. And I don't like falling into, because you know this whole stuff about don't be divisive and so on. And you were mentioning that conflict, you know, let's welcome it. I totally agree. But somehow there's this huge tension because at the end of the day, we need solidarity, right? So I'm just wondering, particularly to them, like, what can we do in these issues? Because we can go there and fight against the youth defence people and so on. But of course, you know, that's what they want, like, ultimately. They want the working class. They want the 99% fighting at each other's throats. You know, and like there is this huge, big struggle that's already attacking something like the water charge movement, which is important. It is an important thing. And so, just wondering thoughts or comments on that. Thanks.
Before Suzanne answers, does anyone else have any more questions? We'll take a couple.
My question is kind of personal. I was just thinking and asking you about how does the movement include women of color? In particular, for this, in general, for this issue, because I think education is important and but representation as well. And how can I be involved when I don't see in this panel somebody that looks like me? And what can we do to change that and to involve women of color in this movement?
Anyone else before we answer questions? Yep.
Suzanne, maybe a quick comment. Please keep me awake for as long as you want. No, that approach is extremely important because any movement that can't hold itself to the same standard that it holds others is doomed to failure. Plain and simple.
Do you just want to answer the question?
Yeah. I guess my gut feeling as to what to do with women or with kind of sexist, racist people in movements is take them out, and that is what my gut would tell me to do, like just end it, take them out, it's not a world I want to be in, but I understand that's not particularly possible. So my reasonable response to this is, because an awful lot of these issues affect me personally, I find it very hard to debate them. So like, I am a woman, I've had an abortion, I'm from a working class background. The only issue that I will ever challenge someone on, and this is a terrible way to go about it, is racism, because that doesn't affect me personally. So I can do it without crying, because every time I get angry, I cry, and then everyone's like, poor you, poor woman, you're crying, we can't take you seriously. And I'm like, I'll strangle you. So I think it is up to kind of allies, as much as I hate that word too, to kind of start debating these things within movements, but also to recognise there comes a point when somebody's not going to change, and at that point it is acceptable for the movement to cut them off. Like, I'm not a fan of call-out culture, I'm not a fan of public shaming of people until it reaches a point where they haven't changed, where they won't apologise for their behaviour, or where they will give you their fake apology of, oh yeah, I'm sorry, and turn around and do it again. So I think the kind of steps I would take are, yes, educate, but also realise that some people are a lost cause and it's time to cut that off.
I'm going to try and speak to kind of two questions at once, if I may. Around the question of solidarity, I mean, I think that's an interesting one. And solidarity, I think, happens, and we can, I look to kind of some historical examples that I'm familiar, and not even that, all that historical, examples from the North. Again, to go back to this issue of fragmentation, I mean, you're right, absolutely, that there are groups like Alliance for Choice emerging, but there still is a huge divide between, and it's not between Republican and Loyalist women as such, it's between privileged professional feminists and those who are active in feminists outside of that. And, you know, as an example, the Women's Studies Centres quite a few years ago were under threat of being closed down in Belfast, and this was during the Troubles, and so there wasn't a lot of kind of solidarity work at that point between women's centres, say, on the Falls Road and on the Shankill. But when City Hall tried to cancel or cut the funding of the Falls Women's Centre because it was deemed to be Republican, that was saved in part because women from the Shankill and other areas, working class areas, came together and stood in the council chambers and shouted down until that motion was rescinded. Similarly, there was an event more recently, about, I'd say, 5 years ago now, an International Women's Day event in City Hall. And only respectable women was the phrase that was being used in quiet whispers in hallways, were invited to attend this. Women of colour, Republican women, working class, women from other working class communities, loyalist women and travellers were not given an invitation to this dinner. They showed up anyway, and they took over the meeting, and cops were called. There was a big ruckus as a result. But I suppose the point of that is that solidarity can come in ways in which we don't expect it to come. So feminists in the North were really preoccupied with this notion of bridge building, you know, getting Republicans and Loyalists together, when it was actually about them checking their own privilege and trying to understand that what they were talking about was not reflective of other people's life experiences. And I think, just to bring it back to your very important question, and the same you know, applies today, I think we tend to kind of talk from and organize from our own kind of perspective, which is what you were speaking to, Suzanne, as well. And it's, I know for myself, like, I'm not from Ireland, and I find it, and I have found it, really, really difficult to even get involved, get active, and to even be seen as having some legitimacy within activist circles in Ireland. It is, I think, and I've lived in other places, really, really difficult. So I think that's something that I would like for us across all of our movements, just not only within our feminist groups, to be much more conscious of. And so that's not speaking directly to your question, but it's skirting around it, I think, in a little bit.
Yeah. I really don't have much more to add that Teresa hasn't already put better than I could. I know that ARC, within the inclusivity policy, that we try to have that accessible language and the translations of all of our materials as far as possible. We also consult with groups who know more about what they're dealing with than we do. So we have been in contact with Akidwa a bit about trying to find out how best we can kind of make the space inclusive for more people to come in, because, as Teresa is saying, it is intimidating and it's difficult to find a way in sometimes when it seems like everybody already knows each other and things are very cliquish. So what I would say is that the Workers' Beer Company, I'm always really amazed that the representation of the population in all our volunteers for all of bar work is far more accurate to reality than the people who are sitting in offices and sitting on panels like this. And that's kind of fascinating. And hopefully a lot of our volunteers from Workers' Beer actually do start to filter into the groups and start to get involved more. So I suppose it's one little way in. And the other thing I'll plug is that we have an open meeting every month in the outhouse. And anybody can come along and there's no obligation to get involved, but it's just a way to hear what's going on. And if you see that there is a gap or a lack in what we're doing, that's what we're always trying to stay very aware of. If you bring it, it's actually a Monday evening in the outhouse at 7 o'clock. So anybody who'd like to come and get involved would be great. Okay.
We have time for one more question if anyone wants to add.
Yeah. I have a question for Elif, and that's in relation to the Khmer system that you have in Kurdistan. Mm-hmm. I would like to know how important you think that that is for the strength of feminism in Kurdistan. And if it was possible, I would like one of the other speakers to give an opinion if they think that that would be possible in Ireland. And maybe, you know, if it would be a system that would be positive for activist movements to get the view of women more stronger when something is done in Ireland.
So, Sarah? So, thank you, Lorena. There's no need to just mention how patriarchy works. We all know. But the most important thing, maybe the patriarchy and capitalism itself works, is just power itself. And power just means seat, and those big and courage, beautiful seats. And the system just builds its upon this one mayor, başkan, what's the başkan? Başkan neydi ya? President, yani there's one president only if you are in a country. One president, if you are in a company, working in a company, there is only one president. Also, the system is goes on with the unity, you know, unity and representation or power just represents itself in a man's body itself. So the system that when we just make those arguments on genealogy and on women philosophy and women, how to build a new women epistemology and so on, we doesn't just argue and say and leave alone. We see the reality that if we couldn't just make in practice some of our ideas, at least, we couldn't just go further. We couldn't do any other thing. So for practicing our ideas or ideals, we say that we need to change the system. We need to change some organizations, how they work, some structure of some institutions. So co-mayorship or co-chairing system is a system that we bring out as a result of these discussions. And how it works, it just works to for dissolving power itself, not to share power, but to dissolve the power itself and for itself. So people used to see a mayor, used to be men on the table and deciding everything, and he sees himself as the biggest man in the world. But now there is not just one man, and there is not just one person on this table, a man and a woman. Co-chair system or co-mayor system. We began this to apply in the our political parties at first, and then we apply this co-chair system in our municipalities, mayors, and now
people see how this system, how this changed the system, the mentality itself. So this co-chair system began to just began to spread around, and now the, for example, worker unions, some of the worker unions, some of the, for example, teachers unions, and some other unions are start to apply this co-chair system in their organizations. And for some irrelevant associations, in terms of organizational state system, I say irrelevant. For example, some associations on religion, or some associations relied on, let's say, ecology or another thing, they began to apply the co-chair system, and actually it empowered us. This system itself empowered us, and now, according to the system, now we have 24 deputies, parliamentarians, in only in HDP, in the Turkish parliamentary. And we have 103 co-mayors in Kurdistan, in northern Kurdistan by itself. But the problem is that it was not an easy process to accept for men and for the power, for the hegemonic system to accept this system, to accept this dissolving power. So that now we said that 103 co-mayors we have, but now I suppose we have around 50 mayors. All of the rest were jailed. All of the rest were taken under custody by the state in last 3 months, let's say, because they see they saw the risk. They saw the risk of this equality, and maybe we can say we need to just the last thing that I want to say. We need to just take some practical steps to make our ideology to push our ideology for steps. That's what I said.
We're gonna have to leave it there. Thanks very much, everyone. The next talk.